God, we thank you, God, today for the privilege and the opportunity that we have at the beginning of our week, God, just to lay our burdens down, God, to receive a refreshing touch from you. Lord, that's what we're believing you for this morning. Lord, that your Holy Spirit would move and operate as he desires to in this place. Lord, that we would be free. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. God, we want there to be freedom in this place, Lord God, freedom to worship you in spirit and in truth, freedom to receive exactly what you want to speak to us this morning. And so, God, remove every hindrance, every foul spirit of the enemy that would try and distract in this service this morning. Let your perfect will be accomplished, and we just give you praise. We give you thanks for all that you're going to do in Jesus' name. Amen. Seek you all of my days. Yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. He doesn't change. Our circumstances are constantly changing. But Jesus is a rock, amen, that we can stand on. He's with us in every storm. He doesn't always take us out of the storm. We would like that, right? But sometimes He's with us through the storm and teaches us. And so praise God for that this morning. Hallelujah.
Raise up a chosen generation. we gather to seek your face. Let's sing verse 2 one more time. Make it your prayer.
Once again, Jesus, hallelujah. We're desperate for you, Jesus. We've made a mess of things in our own lives. We've made a mess of things in our own communities, in our own nation. And Lord, we need to come back to you, Jesus, hallelujah. Let your glory be seen one more time in this land, Lord Jesus, hallelujah. That we would come back to the foot of the cross in humility and brokenness, trembling at your word, and see that there's answers there. Hallelujah. There's breakthrough there, Jesus. You did a finished work for us. Lord, we trust in that this morning. We worship you. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord.
I find Fall down on me, rekindle
morning the Lord is saying there's some that have needs, and I don't know what those needs are, but He does. And it says in His Word, 1 Corinthians 2:9, eye has not seen nor ear heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the things that God has in store for those who will just do what? Simply love Him. Amen? And He knows the needs that you're carrying. You may need healing in your body. You may need emotional healing. You may need finances, provision in your life. You may need peace in the midst of some chaotic circumstances that are bigger than you. We're going to sing this chorus one more time, and let's just do that. As we lift our hands to heaven and surrender, God, I can't fix it, but Lord, You can. Amen? Let's let that be our prayer. Whatever need You're carrying this morning, if we'll just love Him, amen? He's big enough. He's sufficient enough to meet our need. He's the all-sufficient one, amen? El Shaddai, do we still believe that this morning? And I believe the Lord wants to touch some hearts this morning. And so let's let go, amen? Let God work in those situations. I believe some healing's going to take place. I believe some breakthroughs are going to come. And so let's just sing that one more time. As you have a need, just lift it to the Lord. Let Him touch you. Let Him do a work that's undeniably Him this morning. Hallelujah.
All I want to do is love You. All I want to do is worship You. All I want to do is lay here right at Your feet.
Hiding place, Jesus. Hallelujah. When we're hidden in Christ, even Satan can't find us, Lord. Lord, we thank You for that. God, I pray that You'll clear our minds of the lies of the enemy, God, and that only Your truth would prevail in our hearts this morning. God, the enemy would tell us that we're defeated, that we're not going to make it, that the answers aren't going to come. But God, I pray that faith would arise in the hearts of Your people this morning as they hear Your word. as they hear your truth, and God, that they'll have your perspective, your eye view, God, on every circumstance, every situation that they're in. God, let them see that you're sovereign. God, you're in control. You're seated at a place of authority, God. Lord, you purchased us at such a great price to provide everything that we need for life and godliness. Help us to rest in that this morning. God, we just thank you for all that you're doing. We thank you for bodies that are going to be healed, emotional and spiritual healing, God, that's taking place. We thank you for provision, God, that you are still Jehovah Jireh, the God who's made covenant with us to be our provider. And Lord, meet the needs of your people this morning for wisdom and peace of mind. God, only you can give us that. And Lord, we trust you. We thank you that you're our source this morning. We give you praise. Hallelujah. We give you honor. Lord, have your way in the remainder of the service. We submit our hearts to you. God, we yield to what you want to do. Let your word find its place into our hearts this morning and do a deep work. God, we just give you thanks and praise for all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name, hallelujah.
I just want to say that it's been a blessing for me to be here. I certainly do appreciate the chance that Pastor Eric's given me, and to be here with every last one of you. You've touched me and blessed me in different ways, so I just really appreciate that. I know that I was thinking earlier how we want to be the ones that harvest the souls, and we want to see a big church or a lot of people. But someone has to plant those seeds, and that's what I've seen while I've been here, that you have a church, you have a pastor that's not afraid to go out there and plant those seeds for someone else, for the harvest to come. I've lived in Indiana, so I'm used to farming. The planting season is just as busy as the harvesting season. You can't just sit back and expect the harvest to come without getting out there and working. So. Just appreciate seeing that and the initiative here. It's really been a lot to me. So today I'm going to preach a message. I titled "Becoming a Straight Arrow." And I'm coming out of Isaiah 49. Starting with verse 1. Says, "Listen, O isles, unto me, and hearken, you people from afar. The Lord has called me from the womb. From the bowels of my mother he has made mention of my name. He has made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand he has hidden me. He has made me a polished shaft. In his quiver he has hid me. And he said unto me, You are my servant, O Israel, in whom I will be glorified." Will you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, we come to you, and we thank you so much for the worship that we had and the presence that we felt in it, Lord Jesus. We thank you so much for the presence that we felt here. We just can ask that you would open our hearts and our minds to receive your word. Just use me, Lord, to preach your message that you would have me to share. Just bless us in this, and we just give you the praise and all the glory to you, Jesus, in your precious holy name. Amen. Amen. Isaiah would write this, and it's really referring to Jesus. And what he would do, but I'm going to mostly focus on applying it to our life and what it means to us. It says that you are my servant. We know that Christ was a true servant of the Lord, but we're followers of him, and that makes us his servants as well. And the heart of a true servant isn't to point to themselves, but it's to point to the master. So that's what we should really be focusing on, as Pastor Eric was actually talking about, is sharing it with the world. We shouldn't be content with sitting back and just in our four walls and saying we're in church and we're happy here and we're used to, you know, everyone that we're sitting next to. But we need to take that message to the lost and dying world. Mark 16:15, it says, "He said unto them, Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." We know that it's a great commission. But that isn't, sometimes when we hear that, we think it's just for pastors, for preachers, for evangelists, missionaries. But that's for every one of us. Every one of us, if you're saved, you're a servant of God, and we have that same calling on our lives to take that message to people that we meet every day. I know Brother Donnie always says that there's people that you're going to meet that he's never going to run across because they're not going to come to church. And that really stuck with me because each one of us goes to different places. We go to different jobs. We go to school. And we're going to see people that would never come to church. And you might be the only person that they ever come in contact with that's going to share the gospel with them. So that should really be our main focus. A lot of times we get caught up in our day-to-day life. We all have families and jobs, school, bills to pay, stuff that distracts us. And there's nothing wrong with thinking about those things. Obviously, God wants us to take care of our families and do the jobs that he's called us to do, but our main focus shouldn't be just on ourselves and thinking selfishly about what I need to do, what's coming up next. Sometimes we can get so wrapped up in that. But our main focus really should be on spreading the gospel for Jesus. I mean, if you're saved, you know what it's done for your life, and you want to share that with others. I know for myself, it's just what I want to do. It's just something that I say, Lord, help me, use me, take me, help me share the gospel. And the gospel really means good news. So if you've got good news to share, you're not going to keep that to yourself.
Amen.
If someone came up to me and gave me $1 million, I'm not going to say, okay, thank you, brother, and sit down. I'm going to share. I'm going to call my mom. I'm going to say, I've got $1 million. I'm going to post it on Facebook, probably. We should do the same thing with Jesus, though. He's given us so much more than just some type of material gain. He's given us life and life eternally. We should want to share that with others. It should be something that we're constantly sharing, something that we should never stop talking about. A lot of times we can get caught up in thinking, you know, about our purpose. Getting confused, I guess, sometimes thinking, well, what can I do? And Satan will come and he'll use that. A lot of times nowadays we hear a lot about your purpose in life, you know, finding your purpose. If you can only find your purpose, then you'll be happy. Satan will take a truth and twist it into turn it into a lie. And that's what he's good at. That's what he's done from the very beginning. He's taken a half-truth and deceived many, and we'll get focused on ourselves and thinking, you know, if I can find where I fit in life, I'm going to be happy. If I find the right job, if I, you know, whatever it is that you're thinking that you need to focus on. We let different things define us. We let our financial status, the jobs that we have, the people that we know, all of those things we let define us, but that's not really what we should be letting our focus be on. Romans 1:25 says, he who has changed the truth of God into a lie and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. It's taking the focus off of God and putting it on ourselves, on what we can do. And he's twisted that, and he's taken it, and actually taken something that God has meant for good, because we all do have a purpose, and he's twisted that. But what I want to focus on really is what our purpose is in Christ. And each one of us, from the time that we was born, or actually before, God created you with a purpose in mind. Each person here has different giftings and different talents and different abilities that we can use for God, and he's given you those things to share his gospel with others. It says in Psalms 139:14-16, I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, that my soul knows right well. My substance was not hid from you when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Your eyes did see my substance, yet being imperfect, and in your books all my members was written, which is in continuance were fashioned, when as yet none of them were. So we see that all of us, from the very beginning, God's created you for a purpose. Each one of you has something that you can offer the kingdom of God. He's given you these gifts, but it says, as you see in the verse there, verses, being imperfect. But we're all imperfect. We're born into sin. Being imperfect, not being able to do it on our own. The giftings and callings was always there in our lives, but until we knew Jesus, we couldn't come together. It's like, I thought of like a jigsaw puzzle. When you dump it all out, all the pieces are there to do something great. You can fit it together and make a beautiful picture, but it takes someone coming along and finding each piece and fitting them where they need to go. And without Jesus, before Jesus, if we think about it, our lives were just like the jigsaw puzzle. Bunch of jumbled up messes, nothing going where it should be. But once we met Jesus, he took those pieces and was fitting them. And once we let the Holy Spirit use us and work in our lives, he's going to lay out those pieces, and we're going to see the picture coming together that he's had planned for us from the beginning of the time. Sometimes we want to try to fit those pieces in ourselves where they don't belong.
Exactly.
Whenever I would do a jigsaw puzzle, I'd get frustrated sometimes, and you find the piece, and it has to fit there, you try to fit it in, but it doesn't work, and even if you made it work, the picture wouldn't be right. So we have to be willing to submit to God's plan, not trying to force our way, but letting him use us for his glory. He says, he has made my mouth like a sharp sword. Sharp sword refers really to the word of God. And before God can use us, he's got to teach us some things. And we really need to learn the word of God. Nowadays, a lot of times when you speak to people, they may say that they're a Christian, but if you get to talking to them, they really haven't studied and they don't know the word for themselves. And it's not just something that you need to sit back and say, well, my preacher or pastor or whatever is going to do the studying for me and show it, but you need to know for yourself. It says study to show that I am so approved. Even Jesus had to learn the word of God. He was in a 30-year preparation process for a 3.5-year ministry. So you're not in this alone. We all have to start from the beginning. It doesn't matter if you say, well, I don't know and don't understand. God's going to, if you have a heart to learn, he's going to send his Holy Spirit to show you and help you, help you learn the word and reveal it to you. Hebrews 4:12 says, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow. It is a discerner of the thoughts and intent of the heart. So we need to let the Holy Spirit make our mouth sharp, like a sword. And that's really the point of the arrow. It's the word going forth. It's going to touch hearts and reach places that we can't by saying words and wisdom of our own, but it's the Holy Spirit using his word to get to the heart of people. And we need to properly understand the word. We can't just read it. It doesn't have to be something we just know. It has to be something that we apply to our lives and know every day. I know whenever I was younger and I started working, I would meet people and my coworkers and stuff. They would know that I was a Christian. A lot of times when they asked me a question, I didn't really know what to say because I hadn't really studied the word for myself. I grew up in a Christian home, but I maybe did rely too much on my parents' beliefs and didn't really understand why I believe things myself. It has to be something that you know. It can't just be something that someone else has taught you and you say, oh, I've just always done that and I don't know why. It has to be something that you know in your heart that you know. So a lot of times also we don't want to share something because we think we may not say it perfectly right. That was also another fear of mine. I didn't want to start witnessing to someone and then not know what to say and just stand there looking foolish and then scratching their head wondering what I'm trying to say. So it has to be something that becomes part of us. The word of God's not just something that we just read occasionally, but we need to apply it to our lives and let it mold us and shape us into what he wants us to be. When we read the word of God, we see that throughout from the beginning, Genesis to Revelation is really about Jesus and his redemption plan for us. And if we don't see that throughout the Bible, we're not going to properly learn from it. But we see that throughout it, it's talking really about the redemption of mankind. But we don't want to just stop at redemption. We don't want to just stop at justification. We want to go on learning, grow on learning, growing, being transformed, letting the word mold us into what he's created us to be. It says, in the shadow of thy hand he has hid me. The shadow, speaking of Christ, we're hidden in Christ. He is our protection. We can try to face this world on our own, but we're not going to stand very long. We have to be hidden in Christ. Whenever the enemy looks at us, I don't want him to look at me because he knows that I'm going to fail. But I want him to see Jesus. I want to be so hidden in him that he only sees Jesus. Psalms 91:1 says, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. So I want to be hidden. I want to hide under his shadow. I want to be in that secret place where it's just me and God. Let him use me. Let him mold me. Let him speak to me the way that he can. The shadow, and when we think of being hidden in Christ, we think about what all Christ did for us. And when we think about the cross and what Christ went to pay for our redemption and everything else that the cross brought us, we should be encouraged and say, look at what the price God paid for us, and we ought to know that there's nothing that he can't do for us. Whenever he paid such a great price, we ought to know that he's able to supply all of our needs. We don't need to try to do it on our own. We don't need to try to struggle and manipulate situations to get things done, because he's already paid for us to have salvation, freedom, liberty, all of those things he brings to us because of his cross. We just simply need to trust and ask him to help us in every situation. It's simple, and it's unless we try to complicate it and say there's got to be something more. But if we just stop and say, Lord, help me. I know that you bought my salvation, and I know there's nothing else that can come my way that you can't handle. So then he goes on to say, he has made me a polished shaft. That's, when you think about that, he's talking about taking a piece of wood and forming it into an arrow, making it straight, making it polished and smooth, so that when he shoots it, it's going to fly straight. When you think about the process that it takes to a piece of wood that's all bent and knobby and has rough edges on it, and what all God has to do, he's got to trim us down, he's got to sand us off, he's got to make it smooth. Think about the bumps and knobs and stuff in your life that had to be eliminated when you met Jesus, and continues to go on today. Sometimes we think that we're perfectly smooth. We may have some big knots sticking out, and God's over there sanding it down. And we're thinking, ow, what's going on? It doesn't hurt. It hurts to be in the sanctification process sometimes because we want to hang on to it. And God says, no, you've got to get rid of that. I've got to get rid of that and eliminate that from your life so you can move on and continue what I plan for you to do. Sometimes those things are deeply rooted in us. And we say it's been there with us for a long time and we want to hang on to it. But God's got to work that out too. A lot of times trials will come and we'll say, well, what am I doing here? How did I get here? And God's using that. Sometimes we'll say, you know, help me, Lord, take me out of this situation. And sometimes he doesn't, because he's put us there for a purpose so that we can learn and grow from that, so he can remove those things that he doesn't want in our lives. Sometimes we don't always see what's going on, and we get confused. Hebrews 12:11 says, now no chastening for the present seems to be joyous but grievous. Nevertheless, afterwards, it yields a peaceful fruit of righteousness unto them who are exercised thereby. No one wants to be corrected. I think all of us can think back as when we was kids, and you got corrected by your parent. You didn't enjoy it at the time, but I think when you look back, we see that they was molding us and shaping us, teaching us right from wrong. And that's the same thing God's doing to us today. We may not see the error in it, but he has to correct us and show us what's wrong with our lives and what we need to correct and change, and let him use, you know, different situations to do that. Brother Larson always says that we need to yield ourselves to the process. He says that so many times that me and those who's there will sometimes joke about it and say, you know, we just need to yield ourselves to the process, but it's not something that we really should joke about, because that's really what we need to do, is to let God have control of our lives, let Him use every situation, let Him, you know, take everything from us that we don't need to have in our lives. And then afterwards it says that we'll yield the peaceful fruit of righteousness. Once you've let go of the things that you thought you needed, sometimes you've hung on to them for so long, when you actually let go of them, there's that peace there of saying, Lord, you've taken it from me, but yet now I'm actually more happier than what I thought I was going to be, hanging on to whatever it was I thought I had to have. And then sometimes after we've went through all the processes and stuff, we think that we're ready. You know, it's like, the Lord's taken me, He saved me, He sanctified me, or sanctifying me. And you think, I'm ready to be used of God now. But He says, in His quiver He has hid me. And you're standing there and you're thinking to yourself, Lord, I went through all these things. I thought it was for a purpose. And here I am sitting in your quiver. It's dark in here. And I don't want to be here. I thought I was going to be used of you. But He has us sitting there waiting for the time that He's planned for us. A lot of times we might want to try to get out and find some way to shoot ourselves, but it's not going to happen. God's got to take us and use us when He wants to use us. And whenever He reaches back into the river and He pulls out an arrow that's been perfectly formed, it has a straight shaft, it has a point. All the feathers and everything is perfect, and He says, like, this is the arrow that I've created for this time. I have planned you to do this work some time that you was even born. He's going to use you, and you're going to hit that mark that He's created for you, and accomplish the purpose that He created you for. We don't always understand the processes of God. Our ideals of being used by God is always, we think of being seen, being heard, God using us in some great way. But a lot of times the things that God's created, we don't pay any attention to until He's used it. I was studying, and when you start looking at the things that God's used to create and do great works, it normally wasn't by something great and powerful in its own self, but He's taken something so small and insignificant and used it for some purpose that He's planned for it. When we look at Moses, we see a shepherd's rod defeated the armies of Egypt. A cloud the size of a man's hand, bringing the abundance of rain. I used the jawbone of an donkey to kill 1,000 men. And a small stone that lay unnoticed in a brook by Brook Kidron was used. One day David came and picked it up, and he saw the stone. And it was small, it was perfectly smooth, but the water flowing over it, creating it, forming it, shaping it to that size that it was. And he picked it up and said, this one feels good. And he took it, and he killed a Goliath with it. So sometimes you may feel small and insignificant. God may, you feel like it's not seeing you, not using you. But that time will come when He looks at you and says, this is the one that I've created for this purpose. And He's going to take you out of the quiver, and He's going to use you. Sometimes we feel like we've just been waiting there so long. But we need to be patient and just continue to wait on God. Don't try to rush things, but continue just to sit there and wait. 1 Corinthians 1:27 says that, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things that are mighty. So it's, you may seem small, you may seem like you think, I'm not going to be able to do anything, what can I do? But each one of us has a task that He's created us for. And each person has a different gifting, different talents. Like I said, we meet different people. And if we're willing just to let God use us, open our hearts to His word, let Him form us and shape us, we know that we have a message to deliver to the lost and dying world. We say, Lord, help me, use me. Make that your prayer and just say, Lord, use me. Help me to do what you created me to do. we'll see great results from it if we just simply yield ourselves to Him and not try to do it on our own. Whenever God does use you, sometimes we think in our head a certain thing that He's going to use us for. Oftentimes I don't think it's going to be anything like that. I used to hate speaking and talking to people. I used to be so shy whenever I was a kid. I hated to even go to the restaurant and place an order. I was always like asking my mom, please order for me. I don't want to do it. I never would have thought that I would ever be standing up here speaking to people. So if God would have had, if I would have said, what's God going to use me for? I would have never said to preach His word. I would have said, well, I'll probably just do something behind the scenes. No one's going to see me because I'm going to try to stay hidden. But once God, once you actually just say, Lord, help me to find what you want me to do and use me. I remember whenever I was at Bible college, I was in chapel service, and they had a service there, and at the altar call, they was praying, and I just went up front, and I just simply said, Lord, use me, whatever it is. And I felt like He called me into ministry then, and I was like, well, I don't know about that. But since then, He's given me more boldness and the ability to share His word, and I know I'm not perfect yet. I'm sure people could critique this message and say I've made quite a few errors along the way, but I just want Him to use me and let Him be my voice. Whenever I'm speaking, I don't want it to be my words, my thoughts, but it's Him using me, and He can do that with every one of us. Each one of us may do something different. It doesn't have to be preaching. It doesn't have to be some type of fivefold ministry gift. You can be a mom and raise your kids with the Holy Spirit help and say, Lord, help me to raise these kids up in you. Help me to be the greatest worker here at the job. Let them see, let others see Christ in me by the work that I do. Just whatever it is that God has placed you in, it doesn't have to be in a mentality like the world saying that you've got to find a place, but it's saying, Lord, use me. Take me where you want me to go. Show me what I need to know and teach me along the way. So that's really my message today, and I just want to encourage all of you just to take some time and pray to God and say, Lord, use me. Because I know that's not a question, that's not a, something we can ask the Lord that He's not going to answer. He wants to use you. Each one of you, He's created for a purpose and a reason. There's nothing that He's not capable of doing. We look at our own frailties and impossibility in our eyes, but He can take it and use you if you simply say, Lord, just, I give myself away. I'm opening myself up to whatever you want me to do. I'm not hanging on to the things that I thought I needed. I'm letting you take away everything that displeasing to you. Let Him use you. Let Him take all of that away from your heart and just simply open yourself up to Him and say, Lord, here I am. Use me. Isaiah would say, here am I. And I just make that, I just ask you to make that your prayer. Just, here am I. Use me in whatever way, whatever function that you have for me. I'm not looking for glory. I'm not looking for praise for myself. But I want to be a reflection of you, and I want to point others to you. So.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Awesome message this morning. Amen. Every time God speaks to us, He wants an answer. Amen. And the Lord has spoken to Molly this message. I think it's a right now word for those of us who are sitting here this morning. I don't want to add anything to it. I just want to confirm some things. Jeremiah 1, God says to Jeremiah, He says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. I think there's some people in the room that need to know that. Feel like God's forgotten you, or you have no purpose. The message that God gave Molly was to let you know, no, He hasn't forgotten you. In fact, He knew you before you were in the womb. Before you were born, I sanctified you, God said to Jeremiah. I ordained you a prophet to the nations. Then Jeremiah said, like a lot of us do, Ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a youth. Or you can add, I think, without taking away from the gist of that passage, all the other excuses we put there. I am a youth. I can't speak. I'm, you know, whatever. Fill in the blank, right? But God says, do not say, I am a youth, or whatever you put in the blank. He says, for you shall go to all whom I send you. You're going to be the arrow.
Yeah.
Amen. You're going to hit the target for what God has for you. You shall go to all whom I send you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Isn't that easy when we realize that? God, I don't know what I'm going to say. Jesus told his disciples, you're going to stand before kings and governors in the last days. He says, don't go into that ahead of time. What am I going to say? How am I going to answer these people? He says, my spirit will tell you what to say in that moment. And so I believe this message is for all of us this morning. God says, I am with you to deliver you. I'm with you to help you. He told Jeremiah that and used Jeremiah to do a difficult ministry, to tell his people they needed to repent. And God's called us to a difficult ministry in these last days. There's a lot of hardened hearts. Amen. Maybe some of them are your family members this morning. Maybe some of them are people that you work with, people close to you, and you go, God, how are they ever going to get saved? How are they ever going to get their life together before you come back? Because I think it's a short time before Jesus comes back. But we need to be that arrow, amen? We need to stop the excuses and say, God, I'll make myself available to you. And if we do that, I think God can do a lot with us. He can take a little boy's lunch and feed 5,000, amen? He can do it again and feed 4,000. And if we'll just give him what we have, the Lord wants to do something in our lives. Would you stand with me this morning? I want us to put this song on. And can we just take a few moments while this song is playing? The song is Potter's Hand. Most of us have heard that song before. And would you just make the words of this song your prayer? God, I just want to be clay in the potter's hand. You know, if just like the arrow, if it has a knob or an imperfection in it, and that archer goes to reach back into that quiver and pulls it out, it's not going to shoot straight. In fact, he's going to get mad and probably break it into 100 pieces, right? Because it didn't fly straight. That potter, if we don't stay right in the center of the wheel as the potter is shaping it, you know what happens to that clay? I remember we had an art class in 8th grade, and they demonstrated that. And I was like, wow, that's powerful, because it's in the Word of God, where it talks about the potter's house. It slings the clay right off the wheel and makes a mess out of it. And if we don't stay in the center of God's will, which is at the foot of the cross, amen? That's the center of His will. Less of us, more of Him. Then what's going to happen is we're just going to get thrown every which way, aren't we? We're not going to know what's going on. It's going to be a mess. And so as we play this song, would you just say, God, I want to stay in the center of your will. And the will for Molly's life isn't the will of God necessarily for my life. Amen. I'm in a different place. You're in a different place. But it's always at the foot of the cross. God, I want to stay in position where you're speaking, where you're shaping me, where you're molding me. And yes, the pressure when that potter begins to put his thumb on that pot, it hurts. It's rough. God's going to shape us, as Molly preached in this message this morning. There's going to be a sanctification process, but He's just refining us. Amen? Let's let the refiner's fire refine us to look a little bit more like Jesus. So, Molly, if you'll put that song on, let's just lift our hands. Can we just worship the Lord, commit our hearts to Him, and let Him do a work in our hearts, and then we'll pray together and close in prayer. Hallelujah. Can you join hands with that person next to you? Let's pray for each other this morning. Hallelujah. We want to have my dad, if he could, stand in the back. We have a basket back there for cards and gifts for Molly. It's her last Sunday with us. And if you have an offering or a card maybe that you brought, if you want to bring one tonight, we'll have it here tonight as well. We want to bless her. Amen. She may not have had all the hermeneutics and homiletics all together, but she shared a message that God put upon her heart both times that she's preached. And I tell you what, it's blessed me and it's encouraged me. I believe it's done that for you as well. And we want to be a blessing to her. And so I encourage you to give. But let's pray for each other this morning. And let's just say, God, we want to be an arrow in your quiver. Amen. We want God to be able to reach back with confidence with our lives and say, okay, this person's going to hit the target. Amen. They're going to be what I've created them to be because I've refined them in the fire. Amen. Because I've shaped them, because I've molded them. Let's, as Molly said in her message, let's submit to the process. If we're not there where God can grab us with confidence, then God, work out those rough edges. Amen. God, I give those rough edges to you. If you're not saved this morning, you're not where you need to be in your relationship with God. God didn't come to condemn you. Amen. John 3:17, he came to save you. And if you'll just say, Jesus, forgive me. Those things that are coming between me and you, I don't want them to be there anymore. I don't want to have sin in my life. Jesus will forgive you, and you can have a fresh relationship with him this morning by way of the cross. So just do business with God. Let's pray for each other as well. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, this morning for this message that you've spoken to us. Lord, we want to respond in faith. We want to respond out of obedience to your word. Lord, we believe that every time you speak, you want an answer from us. You want a response. And God, for each one of us in this room, the response may look a little different. But God, we want to submit to your will. We want to yield to the shaping and the molding that you're wanting to do in our lives. Lord, we want to be that arrow in your quiver, Lord, that you can reach back with confidence and load into that bow, knowing that it's going to go straight to the target. God, if there's anything in our lives that are keeping that from happening, Lord God, we want to represent you well. Lord, if there's sin in our life, if there's weights that are weighing us down that need to be set aside, God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would help us to lay those things down at the foot of the cross and allow you to free us, Lord. Remove those blemishes, those things that are not allowing us to fly straight to what you want us to be doing, your purpose, your plan for our lives. And God, refine us. Lord, shape us, mold us. Make us a little bit more like you, Jesus. Lord, I pray that when we're in that dark time where we're in a waiting process, God, we're in a place where you're trying to whittle off some more of the flesh, God, that we'll not become impatient, but God, that we'll allow you to do the work that only you can do in our lives. Lord, our lives, we just want to bring you glory. God, we just want to honor you. Forgive us for where we have failed you, God. Forgive us for the times that we've misrepresented you with a bad attitude, with the wrong action, with words that came out of our mouth. Lord, help us to realize this week, Lord, people are watching us. People all around us in the communities that we live in are looking at us because we call ourselves Christian. And let those people see a pure representation of who you are. Because, God, we've been refined in the fire. Because, Lord, we're staying in the center of your will, allowing you as the master potter to shape us, to mold us into vessels of honor fit for the master's use. And God, we want you to use us as you see fit this week. God, maybe there's a homeless person. Maybe there's a person on our job. Maybe it's our next door neighbor. Maybe a family member, God, that you want to use us to reach out and touch with the simple message of the gospel. God, I pray you give us a holy boldness to be tools, instruments in your hand that you can flow through. And God, we just give you praise. We pray for that person on our right and our left. God, have your way in their life. God, let them be fully submitted to you. And God, let them reach their greatest potential, Lord God, in Christ. With their life laid at the foot of the cross, let them see how awesome you are, how mighty you are, how powerful you are. Meet their needs today. God, collectively as a church, Lord, we want to make a difference, Lord, this week for you. So, Lord, send us out, Lord, with your words. Put your words in our mouth, God, so that we have seed to sow. And God, I pray for a harvest, Lord, right here in Colorado Springs. Lord, that we'll see a remnant raised up God, that's going by way of the cross, that knows you, that's walking with you. And God, we just pray for your will to be accomplished. Bless us as we leave this place this morning. We pray that you'll help us to take with us what we've heard in this message and to put it into practice in our lives. Bless Molly, Lord God, for her obedience and speaking what you put upon her heart. And God, let her see eternal results. Lord God, let her hear testimonies of God, how you're using this message to touch lives. We pray for your blessing upon her as she goes back for Bible college in just a few days. Lord, I just pray that you'll give her the best year, Lord God, and that you'll just continue to prepare her. Lord, the lessons and the things that you've done in her life this summer, God, will just build upon what you're doing in her life. And God, we just thank you for the time that she's been able to be with us. Lord, I pray you give us a good week. Keep us close to you throughout the week. Let us be those tools, those instruments in your hand that you use for your glory this week, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.